Welcome to our spectroscopy video. In this video, I'll be introducing spectroscopy, and there's going to be a next video where I'll continue to look at the different other types of spectroscopy. But for now, what is spectroscopy? It is the study of the interaction between radiation and matter. When electromagnetic radiation falls on matter, there are certain changes that occur in matter. And these changes give us information about the structure of matter and in some cases, how much of such matter is present. In other words, I'm saying that spectroscopy could be qualitative, as in telling us the structure of matter, or in some instances, quantitative. In that case, it tells us how much of such matter is present. Now, having said that electromagnetic radiation is going to interact with matter in what we call spectroscopy, what are the types of electromagnetic radiations? We have a list here. This is radio waves, microwaves, infrared radiation, violet lamp, visible light, ultraviolet light. Then we have X-rays and gamma rays. All of them are the seven types of radiations. So in other words, if I had light from a source, let's say a tungsten lamp, if I had that light from that source, the light that is coming out actually will be made up of these different types of radiation we see here. All of them are present in that my light. So the light is called polychromatic. Polychromatic in that it contains radiations of different frequencies. So light from a source is usually polychromatic, like I said, containing all of these different types of radiation. It therefore means that just as we commonly hear that the velocity of light is 3.0 times 10 raised to the power 8, then all of these different radiations will have that same velocity because they are all components of the light. Now, of these seven types of radiation, the one with the highest wavelength is radio waves. So it means that going from radio waves to gamma radiation, wavelength will be decreasing. Then the highest energy and the highest frequency are for the gamma radiation. So gamma has the highest energy of all seven and has the highest frequency. Now, frequency in spectroscopy is preferably measured in terms of what we call a wave number. So you see that symbol, the V with a strike on top. We call it the wave number. So wave number, usually by formula, we say is equal to the inverse of wavelength. So when we invert wavelength, we usually get wave number. And that means if wavelength is in centimeters, for example, then our wave number is going to be in cm minus 1, we pronounce that as reciprocal centimeter. So wavelength can be in reciprocal centimeter, can be in reciprocal meter, depending on the units of wavelength. I'm talking about wave number now. It can be in reciprocal centimeter or reciprocal meter, depending on what? Depending on the unit of wavelength. Now, leaving that, the device used to carry out spectroscopy or used for spectroscopic studies is called a spectrometer. This spectrometer has four main components. The four main components of a spectrometer are the light source, which we said before, of course, will emit light containing all these different types of radiation. And because we may have a particular radiation in mind, so that we want to study its effect on matter, we would need the M, that's the monochromator. What's the work of the monochromator? It selects a particular frequency range of light. That is, when this light comes, it has all of these radiations across different frequencies or different energies. Now, the monochromator helps to eliminate all of them and leave just one. So that if, for example, I want to carry out UV spectroscopy, my monochromator is able to eliminate radio waves, microwaves, IR, visible light, X-rays, and gamma rays. So that the only type of radiation that will come out through it would be the ultraviolet ray. So it's more like we have different kinds of radiation before the monochromator, but after the monochromator, just one type. Then the monochromator, if you remember before we mentioned them like polychromatic light, polychromatic, the light here, right? So after passing through the monochromator, our light becomes monochromatic, meaning what now? Light of one type of radiation or having one energy range only. Now that light, that monochromatic light, is going to pass through our sample, the substance we are about to study, the matter, as a matter of fact. The light is going to pass through it, and that sample will be held in what we call a cuvette. So the C there stands for the cuvette, and the cuvette is the sample holder. That's another name for it. We call it sample holder. That's where your sample will be. Now, when the radiation passes through that sample, some of the radiation will be absorbed by the sample, while the rest of it will pass. In that case, we say some of it will be transmitted. So there's absorption and then there's transmission of the rest of it. Then D there stands for detector. There are different types of detectors, and these detectors are actually able to, as it were, detect how much of this radiation eventually passes, and then they can give us further information about the substance being studied. Now, leaving that, here we're talking about changes. And what do I mean by changes? When radiation hits matter, what kind of changes could occur in the matter? Remember, matter is made up of atoms, and atoms are made up of subatomic particles, including the electrons. So by the time radiation hits matter, one change that is possible for matter is excitation of its electrons. And what do you mean by excitation of electrons? Normally, electrons could exist in what we refer to as ground states, or you may say that an atom is in the ground state, and this ground state is usually a stable state, whereas there's a second possible state that we refer to as the excited state. The excited state is not very stable, however, it is a state of higher energy. So if excitation were to occur in a substance, the excitation will involve the substance absorbing energy. After absorbing energy, yes, the electrons go to an excited state, but because that state is not stable, what do we expect of the electrons? They will find their way back to the ground state. In that case, they emit some more radiation or energy. So energy is absorbed and emitted during this transition, during this excitation, followed by a return to the ground state. So such excitations usually occur when ultraviolet light is passed through matter. So if the radiation is of the UV type, what do we expect of matter now? We expect that excitation is what will occur in the matter. But if the radiation passed is of the IR type, infrared, then what usually occurs in matter is vibration. Vibration occurring in matter may have to do with the bonds. We say bonds are usually considered to be elastic, the bonds in a compound. Like when you have a carbon to carbon bond, we say that bond can be treated like a spring. It is elastic, it is able to make certain vibrational motions. Now, leaving the unnecessary details, we say that there are three types of vibrations usually that are observed in molecules when they are hit by IR radiation. And these types of vibrations include stretching, so the bond may actually stretch. Then there's also bending, and then apart from that, there's rotation. So stretching, bending, and rotation are types of vibrations that could occur in matter when it is hit by IR radiation. Then, in the case where radio waves are our choice of radiation, when we use radio waves to hit matter, when radio wave comes in contact with matter, What happens in matter is described as nuclear transition or change in nuclear spin orientation. When this occurs, of course, like we said, it could eventually lead up to us having certain information about the substance being studied. Summary of what we have on this side now. When radiation hits matter, it could lead to excitation, that's if the radiation is UV, could lead to vibration if the radiation is IR, and then it could lead to nuclear transition or changes in nuclear spin orientation, that's if the radiation is radio waves. And in that case, where we have radio waves, our spectroscopy will be referred to as NMR spectroscopy. We'll talk about these three different types of spectroscopy very soon. But for now, we'll turn our attention to the first type, which is UV spectroscopy. For UV spectroscopy, we are going to be passing what type of radiation onto matter now? Of course, UV radiation, ultraviolet radiation. And this ultraviolet radiation is known to have frequencies between 85 and 400 nanometers. So this is actually NM, so nanometers. That's the frequency range for the ultraviolet light or in the ultraviolet region. Now, by the time we have our light source, we have our monochromator, what is coming out from our monochromator? UV light. That UV light is going to fall on a sample contained in a cuvette. Now, this cuvette is not the glass type. We don't use a cuvette made of glass for UV spectroscopy. Why? The reason is glass absorbs ultraviolet light. And since glass absorbs ultraviolet light, it's possible, very possible, that when we pass this ultraviolet light through our sample, while the sample itself will absorb some of the UV light, the glass will also absorb part of the UV light, so that we get a wrong impression of how much absorption occurred there. We may feel like plenty absorption has taken place. Our sample has absorbed so much, whereas the sample actually absorbed little and glass absorbed the rest. So we use a material that does not absorb UV light to make our cuvette. In that case, what is commonly used is quartz. So if we're asked what the sample holder is in UV spectroscopy, we say it's quartz. And why don't we use glass? It absorbs UV light. Now, the sample we are going to put inside that cuvette, in what state of matter should it be? Usually, it is in solution. So we have the sample inside our cuvette, and then we add solvent to it so that we have formed a solution of our sample, and that will now be put inside the spectrometer and light is passed through it. Now, at the end of the light passing through, on a computer screen, we are going to see a plot. That plot is called the UV plot, and that UV plot is usually a plot of what we call absorbance against frequency. So it shows us how much of the ultraviolet light is absorbed by the material under study across this frequency range. Say, okay, along this very frequency, that's where the absorption was highest or otherwise. So we call this a UV plot, and we said it's a plot of absorbance against frequency. But remember, frequency, wavelength, energy, they are all related. We have our E equals HV as a formula relating them. So you may actually have this plot as a plot of absorbance against wavelength, like you can see here, or a plot of absorbance against frequency. So it could be any of them, really. Now, having said that, I've mentioned absorbance. What really is absorbance? In terms of the light passing through this sample in a cuvette, by the time radiation comes to a cuvette this way, and this is sample in it. Some of this radiation will be taken in by our sample, while the rest will pass out of the covert. This process of radiation being taken in by our sample is called absorbance. And then the passage of radiation without being collected by our sample is called transmittance. So there's absorbance and there's transmittance. And of course, like you'd expect, they will be inversely related, inversely proportional to each other. Why? If much is absorbed, it definitely means that only very little will be transmitted. And if little is absorbed, it means that much will be transmitted. So in that case, we expect that absorbance will be inversely proportional to transmittance. And true to that, they are related by a formula like this that says absorbance is the negative logarithm of transmittance. And this is inverse proportionality. So if one of them is high, the other will be low. Then there's a formula we use for calculating absorbance. This is it. A equals ABC. Now, it's not always written as ABC. In some other cases, other symbols are used. However, the meanings remain the same. Now, A in my formula is absorbance. Of course, we said absorbance has to do with how much of the radiation is absorbed, right? Then, the small a is absorptivity. Now, absorptivity is usually a constant. Absorptivity is a constant. And in some instances, in place of absorptivity there, what we use is called molar absorptivity. Now, molar absorptivity for a substance is usually the absorptivity divided by the molar mass. So absorptivity per unit mass or absorptivity divided by the molar mass is what we call molar absorptivity. So in some texts, you see that this small a is written as molar absorptivity. Then B here represents path length. What do you mean by path length? This covert, its diameter or its length from side to side is what we refer to as path length. That is the distance through which the material will pass over the sample. All right, so we have our sample inside the covert. Usually it nearly fills the covert. So the distance through which the radiation will pass through the covert is referred to as the path length or optical path length. In some cases, we call it optical path length. Then the C there stands for concentration. Concentration of what? Concentration of our sample. And usually we want the concentration of the sample to be appreciable, to be reasonable. That's why I said here we use a large concentration. But of course, in many instances, to make your work easy, the concentration does not have to be very large, like excessive. Instead, you have a certain amount, a sizable amount of your sample, and then you have solvent added to it such that there is still some. If your sample, for example, is colored, you can still see the color of your sample. So the concentration should be fairly large. It should be reasonable. It should be enough to give you results so that you don't end up using a blank solvent. So that's A equals ABC, a formula for absorbance, and that formula is known as an expression of the Beer-Lambert law. So when we have the Beer-Lambert law, the law of Beer and Lambert, we know that it is this formula that represents it mathematically. So it says absorbance equals absorptivity times what? Path length times concentration. Okay, so these are basics of UV spectroscopy. Remember, we said that you get a plot which will give you information about the structure of that substance. How that works is beyond the scope of this video. So away from UV spectroscopy, the next thing I'll tell you about on this side is IR spectroscopy. IR spectroscopy is very similar to UV spectroscopy. You still have your four components of the spectrometer. Everything still happens just like this. However, major differences would include, first, the kind of covert you use, the sample holder. In this case, what we use as sample holder is rock salt. Rock salt. The sample holder is not made of quartz this time. It is made of rock salt, and that's because quartz absorbs IR radiation. Then beyond that, the sample that is to be used can be in any state of matter. It can be gas, can be liquid, can be solid, any state of matter. And then we usually need a small amount, a very small amount of the sample to achieve our study, to achieve spectroscopy. Then beyond that, in this same IR spectroscopy, of course, we won't be passing UV light. Instead, we'll be passing IR radiation. So infrared radiation is what passes through the matter. And remember, we said it could lead to vibration, stretching, bending, rotation. And in the end, what do we get on our computer screen? We get a similar plot, a plot of absorbance against wavelength or absorbance against frequency. So the techniques are similar, very similar. But here's something we should note about UV and IR spectroscopy in terms of application. IR spectroscopy is very important when we are carrying out functional group determination. Functional group determination. So to determine functional groups in organic compounds by spectroscopy, not by other methods, not by chemical analysis, we prefer to employ IR spectroscopy. So sometimes in exams, you see the question of the functional group in an organic compound can be determined by which of the following spectroscopic techniques. So that's not to say spectroscopy is the only way we can determine functional groups. You can determine functional groups, like I said, chemically by test tubes. You carry out chemical tests using your tubes. But in the absence of that, if you were to use instrumentation, if you were to use spectroscopy, then you'd want to carry out IR spectroscopy. It's the one of choice in this case. And then it is important to mention that IR spectroscopy is especially useful for species that have dipole moments. Species that have dipole moments. So species that have dipole moments are especially IR active. They absorb IR radiations very readily. So they are good candidates for IR studies. And then also, if you have, let's say, an alkene, for example, look at this alkene. This alkene is asymmetrical. Asymmetrical in what sense? It is asymmetrical in the sense that if you were to divide this alkene into two across the double bond like this, the resulting right and left halves will be different. So we say in that case that the alkene is asymmetrical. This kind of alkene will be IR active. But if you had an alkene of this other form, what we can call butuin now, this will be IR inactive. Why? It has symmetry. So having symmetry is just almost the same as not having dipole moments. So species with dipole moments, including asymmetrical alkenes and alkynes, yes, they are IR active. But other compounds that do not meet these requirements are usually IR inactive. Whereas for UV spectroscopy, we say it is especially applicable to compounds that show conjugation, compounds that have conjugated double bonds. A conjugated system is a system like this one. When you have double bonds separated by single bonds, carbon to carbon double bonds separated by carbon to carbon single bonds, you say that the double bonds are conjugated, or you say that this system is conjugated. Some other persons describe a conjugated system as one in which there are alternating double and single bonds. So when double and single bonds alternate, we call it conjugation. And conjugated systems like this are very highly UV active. They absorb plenty of UV light. So those are some important tips for the exam. Having said those about UV and IR, especially in relation to the exam, we are going to spend the bulk of our time on this third type of spectroscopy, which is spectroscopy. And I agree, or I think you'll agree with me, that this is where the problem really lies, NMR, especially when it comes to talking about number of peaks, number of splits, number of signals. These are terms that many of us do not understand. So I'll tell us about those terms as simply as possible. I'll try to keep this whole discussion as simple as possible so that by the next video, which will be strictly on NMR, I'll show you all of these details. So please watch the next video, which is Spectroscopy Part 2, which is basically going to be all about NMR spectroscopy.